I think that would be sick. You think the world's ready? They better get ready.
I'm Colin Burrows, and this is the Woodstein Media Podcast, Episode 4. This podcast is adapted from interviews conducted for articles on woodstein.ca, and it is produced on the lands of the Mississauga, Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, Anishinaabe, and Odawa peoples. This episode features a conversation conducted with Jillian Clair, vocalist of MVLL CRIMES. The interview was conducted when their first 12-inch EP, You Embarrass Me, was released on Cursed Blessings Records in September 2022. We talked about everything from MVLL CRIMES to Jillian's day job in the City of London's record department and many other bands rocking out in Ontario. So there's a lot of great music that I hope is new to you. This podcast and Woodstein Media are independently produced journalism that you can support through Patreon or by donating through PayPal at woodstein.ca. That's WOOD-STEIN.ca. If you enjoy this podcast, you can support it by listening to more episodes and liking, sharing, subscribing, or reviewing them. Now, I'm kicking off this episode with the song Pay For It by MVLL CRIMES. Go kind of out of order on this because I want to start off with your ideas, your songs. They're timely, they're profound sometimes. They're almost exactly what I'm thinking or living through. Pay For It, you channel all my neighbors. So where did these ideas come from? What are you doing the band for?
I saw Amble and the Sniffers earlier this year, and I bring that up because the lead vocalist said something that I think just encapsulates this really perfectly, which is that writing a song is a way of expressing all of the things you struggle talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And so the only thing I think I have to add to that is things in life seem so overwhelming and can seem hopeless, and it's so nice to kind of get your ideas all out, like on anything, be it a page, you know, be it a screen, be it a song, be it a recorded song. So I'm fortunate enough to have this platform to explore these ideas and get feedback for it too, right? Which is such a special thing. I think maybe more directly to answer your question, yeah, it comes from a feeling of being really overwhelmed and not being sure how an individual is supposed to tackle these large systemic issues and struggling with those feelings of frustration and helplessness.
Some of those ideas or some of the songs almost sound like what people would put down in a personal zine, and I know you are involved in zines too. Which came first, for one thing? Were you into zines and then got into music, or were the other way around?
I made my first zine about 9 years ago, and the first band I was ever in started about 2 years after that. Okay. But I moved to London when I was 18, and I tried relatively quickly to be involved in live music. So as a consumer and wanting to be involved in the music community, I would say that's been long, and that's been around for longer. And I always saw zine making as a way of still participating in that community, even if you're not necessarily in a band or playing an instrument, because there's sort of all these complementary crafts, honestly, like you're doing right now, right? Like the folks who are like making zines and doing interviews and hosting radio shows, doing, you know, podcasts and taking photographs and shows, that like kind of go in and like make for a really rich music scene. So don't necessarily need to play an instrument to participate in a community around music, but I am really fortunate that I get to wear multiple hats.
It is a community. You're younger than I am. I know Patrick. It's like these scenes all, it's weird. I was watching something with Kevin Bacon on it.
Yeah.
And they were talking about the 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon.
Yeah.
And how so many people know each other. Like, communities are so small. My band, this was 10 years ago, so I guess when we met Patrick. But yeah, those communities are really special, and they come together, and
That's so true. It's exactly. Worth acknowledging.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like one bleeds into another, I think. There's this real endurance of music community. Like, I'm really fortunate. I know the person who used to book, I never got to go to this venue in London, but this, the Embassy.
Okay.
And she is just kind of this wealth of knowledge and like this historian of like specifically punk music in the southwestern Ontario for like 20 years now, and it's great.
Are you talking about Genevieve?
I am talking of Genevieve. Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
That's it again.
Yeah.
Yeah, because we know her from booking at the Embassy and then Brennan's and all these venues that end up, even if the venues disappear, the connections don't, the people don't.
That's right.
They just move on to new,
find a new
spaces.
Spot.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and that's really cool. So, yeah, that's kind of what I think I was getting at. Like, the spirit of when I try to talk to a Google or whatever, Google Home, it never gets the name of the band right, so I can't, unless I pull out my phone.
Yeah, of course.
But, it's Small Crimes, right?
It is Small Crimes. To set the record straight, it's Small Crimes.
Okay. That's what I thought. Yeah. That's what I knew. But yeah, Small Crimes, it reminds me of when I first heard bands back when I was a teenager. It's really exciting music. And that's the other connection. New people meet old people, and the communities are connected by this really exciting art. When I hear it, it reminds me so much of like putting on, I don't know, Minor Threat or something when I was 15 and getting that charge out of it.
Yeah.
I'm getting that again.
That's such a huge compliment. I mean, like, I just can't say enough good things about the people who I'm in this band with, who I am currently watching carry in lots of heavy gear. as I sit comfortably with wonderful company. And I think one of the things that means so much to me about this band is just the musicianship. It's just so high. Every individual, like, musical component is just, it's the best. When we first played, when we played our very first show, wonderful friend, Davida, who you also may know, she referred to us, I think, in a post as a super group. We were playing an event for her, for a festival she does. Like, obviously, that means a lot. It's a huge, huge compliment as well. But it's like, Evan, insane drummer, just unbelievable in many aspects. His fills are basically unmatched. Pat, like, incredibly creative guitar player, and we live together, so I know he works at it all the time, so shout out to Pat. And then Lori, like, I mean, we could just talk about, I think, Lori and her contributions to, like, London specifically, her caliber as a bass player, just for, like, the rest of this interview, you know, so it's...
Yeah.
Yeah, it helps. And it helps you with
the talented
thing.
People. That's the thing, it's not just, like, I think your lyrics hit something that no one else is hitting right now that I can really relate to, but it is the music too. It's, I listen to and enjoy a lot of bands that are of lesser musical quality, but you guys do have a caliber that really hits. Like, that guy right there is an amazing guitarist.
Yeah, he really is amazing guitarist.
Even in Foam was doing things. We loved playing with them because they were making different sounds. It was really kind of maybe grungy.
I think so.
Yeah, what they were doing. And because it reminded us of Nirvana or something like that.
For sure.
A lot. And we loved that. So that was awesome. And...
Yeah.
That's Pulling on the Till by Foam off their album So Anyway, available from foamlondon.bandcamp.com. You've got great musicians behind you, and so what plans do you guys have for the future?
Yeah, we really want to go on tour. Haven't toured yet.
Have you toured with any band you've been in?
Colin, no, I have not.
Okay.
I'm ready. I'm hungry for it. I've heard many road stories. You know, I have some folks in my life who are pretty experienced touring musicians, and I really want to do it. I am a extremely under-traveled person. I have seen barely any of this country, never mind any country. So if there's some way to be able to see more of Canada, more of the world, and also do something I love and I feel so much satisfaction doing at the same time, it's a dream come true.
And is the rest of the band on the same page with you?
I believe they are, yeah.
Okay, that's awesome. Because I know I had lineups where I was ready to hit the road, other people weren't, so that can be a pain. But
That sounds like a frustrating spot to be in, for sure.
Yeah, so... and you just had an album come out. How do you feel about the songs on there?
It's our best work to date, easily.
That's saying a lot.
Thank you. We've had the pleasure of recording at the Sugar Shack with Kyle Ashbourne twice now for like physical releases, three times factoring in an Incorrect Thoughts session we did, which is like a, I know you know what it is, but the like live off the floor, like you get recorded while you're playing the songs, and then you also get these like great sound recordings out of it. It's very cool.
And videos.
So I think and I know we play the songs better live than how they're recorded, and I think that's saying a lot because they sound great. So selling the records, we wound up with like this incredibly generous, supportive record label called Chris Blessings Records, and they've been incredibly supportive. We would not be putting this album out without them, from literally like the pressing of the record to even just finishing some of the songs that are on this release. One in particular called Foods began as a jam, which we just sent to them to sort of be like, this is what we're working on, this is what we're sounding like these days, and they fortunately like really liked it despite it being pretty silly and remaining a pretty silly song, and it's been a real pleasure working with them. So
these are the foods that I don't eat: bacon, chicken wings, ground turkey, sirloin steak, lamb chops.
And that was Foods I Don't Eat by Mall Crimes off their debut 12-inch EP, You Embarrass Me, on Curse Blessings Records, available at curseblessingsrecords.com.
Like making sure the record has like the energy and the enthusiasm behind it that I think it enjoys, because it's been like a lot of work and highly anticipated. I don't know if you've been impacted by this vinyl shortage at all, but man oh man.
You were talking about the jam being kind of silly.
Yeah.
But that's another thing. Your songs are really serious, but there's a sense of humor to them. They're not, and I don't mind things that are just preachy too, but they're not just preachy.
Me neither. So. Yeah, probably in high school when I first learned about satire, you learn about like the Horatian and the Juvenilian type of satire, and one is something like a modest proposal, and another one is something which is deliberately just like scathing and cruel. And so Horatian is the modest proposal example, and that has all, it's always clicked with me in a way, just you are able to get across a lot more if you're prepared to present very serious things with a bit of humor than if you're just like bashing someone over the head with it.
Yes.
Not that doesn't have its place, you know?
Sometimes it does.
Sometimes it does. Sometimes
there's, you've tried the humor, you've tried to make it a little more subtle, and you just have to go in with a sledgehammer.
It's time for the trump card, as it were, yes.
That's not a very good word anymore.
No, it's lost, I heard it when I said it, it's lost some of its meaning.
Yes.
Some of the meaning it maybe had pre-2016, if you would.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll go with that.
Okay.
Yeah. Is there anything you wanted to talk about or would like people to know that we haven't talked about?
I think the, like, in the broadest sense, the punk scene is having a really interesting time right now. There's been a bit of a resurgence of pop punk, which I think, not that like trickle down economics is real, but I do think people need an entryway to punk music somehow. And if you don't have a punk in your life, then these more palatable iterations of punk music can be a really great gateway. And to anyone who is interested in punk music and maybe wants to become more involved in their local scene, like, the best thing to do is to show up, you know, like, come out there. More often than not, is a lot of very friendly people there who will be excited that you're interested in this music and want to be more involved. And then just like, you know, just like we were talking about earlier, you don't necessarily need to be in a band to be involved in your community, right? Participation is more than enough. You know, you can make zines, you can do interviews, you can take photos. It's a place that really nurtures artists, right? From like many different practices of art. And if you want to be more involved in your punk community and want to come check out a Mall Crimes show, that would be sick. We'd love to have you. Please say hi.
Is Mall Crimes taking up most of your time, or are you still doing zine distribution and making zines and doing other things as well?
Oh, man, I made my first zine in probably since the last release we had. I usually make a zine when we have something physical coming out.
Yeah.
And yeah, first one maybe in almost a year for the record that's coming out tomorrow. Yeah, Mall Crimes. I have like a pretty dull full-time job, which frankly I'm very grateful for, but yeah, it takes up a lot of my time, right? Like, and I'm sure you get that, right?
Yeah,
like,
I get
that. It's really easy to get sucked in, you know? You gotta stay on top of social media, you gotta stay on top of your emails. This whole aspect of like not just having an active social media presence, but when to post and what to post is like...
Also off the You Embarrass Me 12-inch, that was Arguing with Strangers by Mall Crimes.
I was speaking to this really nice guy, Marcus, who does a podcast called Deep Dive Discography, just about, you know, the many different hats you gotta wear if you want to be making music and, like, you know, 2022 and beyond, and it's so real, you know. And I love learning new things, so it's great for me, but it also can be a little all-consuming, you know.
Yes.
When you're like, I have been staring at this computer for 4 hours on top of the 8-hour shift I just work, like, oh, like world's smallest violin, 8-hour shift. But like, it can be a lot, right? You're like, I mean, you should probably, you know, drink a glass of water.
Yeah.
Usually a good idea.
Yeah. I totally get that. And I totally get what you were saying, especially right now, because I'm running for... be deputy mayor of...
Are you really?
Yeah. I've kind of had to say, well, there's all this stuff already out there on social media about me, so I can't change that now.
Yeah.
But with jobs and stuff, you kind of do have to think about what you're posting. And I've got to a point where it's already out there.
Well,
I can't stop it.
There needs to be more punks in politics, specifically on the municipal level, because that's where so much gets done, like more than I think most people realize. I say that as someone who is a employee of a municipality.
Is that, that's what you're doing right
that
now?
That's my gig.
Are you at London?
I'm in City of London, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do you do?
Excellent question. I work in the clerk's
and
office.
Is this off the record?
No. This is on the records because I am a records systems analyst.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm one of the staff who handles the freedom of information requests that the city receives. So, yeah, you'll learn a lot.
Wow. Okay. And before that, when I was working as a journalist, following my local city, actually, I was able to get by without ever having to make a request.
Yeah?
Because, yeah.
Wow.
It's a small town area, so I was able to talk to people, and eventually they'd go, well, this is off the record, Colin, but this is... And you don't use that, but you get
a
the information.
Close to the mayor, yeah.
Yes, you get that. So, yeah, it's interesting.
You know, I love it when journalists come through, because it's like, I know I'm going to learn about, like, something juicy isn't the right word, but often it's a matter that, you know, like, a journalist is following that lead for a reason. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And this is also not off the record, but the piece of legislation regarding freedom of information that municipalities deal with, it's called NFIPA, and in my personal opinion, institutions get way too much latitude in what they consent to release. And, like, you know, there's a process for appealing those decisions, but, you know, there's a, like, a timeliness, like, specifically when it comes to journalism. So not every journalist has, like, 120 days to go through the appeal process and maybe get those records that they're trying to get.
Yeah, that's the other thing. Everything I was doing had to be done. It was a weekly paper.
Yep.
I had to have it done for the next week's paper.
Yeah.
Even if there would have been no appeal, it's doubtful I would have got it in time.
Yeah, exactly. Because you have 30 days to finish it, right?
And,
you know, you try to do work as quickly as you can, but yeah, sometimes you need those full 30 days. Yeah. Yeah, it's good. I'm glad a mechanism like this exists, because people should have access to the records that a municipality is creating. And you can do it, like, with a university and, you know, with a hospital. Yeah. People should have access to these things, but I have nothing but confidence in the, like, information and records team at the City of London, but there's certainly some decisions I've seen from higher up that I'm like, it's a bit too, like, what's the term, COA, and not enough focus on, like,
COA.
Cover your ass. Cover our asses.
Okay.
And I had, when someone first used that expression with me, I was like, I don't know. I don't know what that means.
Well, I'm used to it being Chachi On Acid, so I was like, they don't listen to us in there, do they? Maybe.
Yeah, I've definitely thrown a Chachi On Acid song on the cans before, while at work. There you go.
We're told that after the war, the Nazis vanished without a trace. But battalions of fascists still dream of a master race. The history books will tell of the defeat of 45. But they all came out of the woodwork on the day the Nazi died. They say the prisoner at Spandau was the symbol of defeat, whilst Hest remained imprisoned and the fascists they were beat. So the promise of an Aryan world would never materialize. So why did they all come out of the woodwork on the day the Nazi died? The world is riddled with maggots. The maggots are getting fat. They're making a tasty meal of all the bosses and bureaucrats. They're taking over the boardrooms and they're fat and full of pride. And they all came out of the woodwork on the day the Nazi died. So if you meet with these historians, I'll tell you what to say. Tell them that the Nazis never really went away. They're out there burning houses down and peddling racist lies. And we'll never rest again until every Nazi dies.
That was Chachi On Acid with special guest Hildegard vonSmoochy on lead vocals, covering Chumbawamba's On the Day the Nazi Died, available on chachionacid.bandcamp.com. And you can also find more from Hildegard vonSmoochy at smoochy.bandcamp.com.
You've got me on a topic that I have so many feelings about.
Okay, interesting. Yeah. I didn't expect to be on that topic. I don't know whether it'll work into this.
That's fine. That's fine. You can take it, you can leave it. I have...
And none of it's off the record, you said, so...
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect. I think on mall crimes, I think I have everything I need.
Brilliant.
And there's nothing else you want to say about the world?
Let's see here. I'm very happy with where this interview and where this conversation has led so far. So, I really appreciate your time. I love that Beaver Slap article you wrote. I thought it was just so great, really great piece of writing, and what an interesting band too.
Yeah.
I'm really hoping we can make it out to Barry. We were in touch with some of the Tarantula Tapes folks not that long ago, so hopefully we can make it out to that part of the province soon. Because everything I've heard about, like, the music community out there, it's like really, it's like very DIY, which I love, which is sort of like where I come with shows and stuff, like both the playing of and the booking and the promoting. So shout out to Barry.
Awesome. To Barry. Yeah.
I wanna do. I don't know why I come out here.
Okay, so the band I chose to represent Barrie Ontario's Tarantula Tapes label is actually from Toronto, I believe. I just think the Black Voids, IDWGOWY, is a great song. And if you agree, it is available on their Sad Songs About Sentient Sex Toys and Other Terrible Tales cassette at tarantulacassettes.bandcamp.com. Beaver Slap themselves have split into like three or four things that are all worth listening to of all. They're doing everything from drum and bass to like weird folky stuff to
I love it. And Angry Spells is a bit of a branch off. I really want to play with Angry Spells so bad. They rule.
For me.
Gravitate, ain't no gravity secure me. If you come step with me, I'll never make you sorry. For me, tell you how I knew that you were for me. Tell me all your stories, never bore me. We belong together in this story.
That was a Beaver slap block that followed the members to new projects. It started off with Beaver slaps Yoko and John. Next up was Angry Spells with Whatever Feels Good. After that, the sounds of Savvy C's contributions to the Liquid Love EP took a different musical direction with some drum and bass sounds. Then Idol of Fear finished it out with the darker sounds of In the Cold Light of Dawn. To learn more about how Beaver Slap grew into all of these projects, read the article, What the Heck Happened to Beaver Slap? On woodstein.ca. And catch Angry Spells and Mall Crimes doing some gigs together in 2023.
Thanks awesome. So much, Colin.
Yeah, thanks for taking the time to talk to me. And
it's been a pleasure. Yeah, you know, I think I may have met you at a Chachi On Acid show many years ago, but it's so nice to be reacquainted.
Okay.
Yeah. The show I'm thinking of was at Richmond Tavern.
Okay.
And I remember being like...
We did some really messy ones there.
Blown away. Yeah, I think you had... someone... Like a 16-year-old, like a kid playing.
Oh, that's my son.
Is that your boy? Oh, yeah. He ripped it.
Yeah, he's our bass player. Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah.
And he'd have to like stay on the other side of the Richmond.
Right.
And just wait to play his set.
Yeah.
And
then,
yeah.
Yeah.
And even when, as he got older and people were starting to offer him alcohol and stuff, he was like, no thank you, no thank you.
Just not his thing.
It's his thing now.
Well, there you
he's
go.
He's 25 though now.
So.
Yeah, so, yeah. How old are you?
32.
Okay, so yeah, you were, he's 7 years younger. Okay. But he was probably still pretty small when you first saw that.
Yeah, it was, I don't know, it's great. I know, like, I've had some talks this year just about, like, all ages shows and the constant lack of all ages shows. There's this great band in London called Thunder Queens. Every member is, like, under 18. They're all, like, 14, 15. And I know they have situations where they will open a show and then immediately have to leave because none of them are allowed to be in the bar, right?
Yeah.
Sucks.
From their self-titled EP, that was Thunder Queens with Stereo Cat. Check them out on yahrightrecords.bandcamp.com. When I was young, we were all like 15, 16, 17, starting to go to shows, and that was awesome. We have like an X on our hand or whatever, and we couldn't buy alcohol, but it was awesome to that it was there for us, because how do you get younger people playing if they're not able to see it?
100%, 100%, you know, and like, thank the Dark Lord for house venues in that regard, right?
Yeah.
It does kind of like provide that space, but at the same time, house venues themselves can be very fraught. Like, it's not always like the best folks like running a house venue. So London, as far as I know, is really lucky right now. There's two house venues I know of, and like, both of them are run by like very, very nice people. So
yeah, I've played house venues that were amazingly well taken care of, and then house venues where there was sewage leaking up through the floor.
Was that in London?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I heard about that house. I wasn't there, though. Help us.
Yeah, but, yeah. I was there, literally shit coming up through the floors.
Oh, God, man.
That was... Yeah. Yeah. It was really weird.
Yeah, it was wild.
So, well, thanks again. And
thank you. Yeah. I'm so glad you were able to make it out tonight. It's really nice to talk face to face.
Yeah, yeah. So, and it's, and thanks for the review you gave of my zine a long time ago.
That was so fucking good. I like that zine so much. Yeah, I should have mentioned that during the interview, how good that Buzzcock zine is. I'm sorry, I was so caught up in talking about myself.
I don't think I've shut this off.
Oh, good.
Or maybe I have.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, I love that zine. I point to it as this example of just like information sharing that's so well done, because you, like, in addition to the Buzzcocks, you mentioned like so many of the bands that influenced them or were coming up around their time, or that they in turn influenced, and it's like, that's like, that's so nice. Like, there's no part that feels like, you know, you're being spoken down to, or like, you know, you're taking a position of like, don't you know about Joy Division already? And I, like, you know, it's too bad that often conversations or publications about music do take that tone, but like, yeah, I can't say enough good things about that. That's, pick it up. Is it still on the what's the name of that distro it's on?
Microcosm,
thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, they published it. They, so it's
awesome.
All right.
Well, I will go tend to my band, see if they've left any anything for me to bring inside, but I don't.
That was Mall Crimes again off their Bootlicker's Delight EP, reminding you, don't be a cop. Thanks for listening. Thanks to Jillian for the interview. Check the description wherever you are listening to this for links to more information on how to get music by all the bands that were played on this podcast, or visit woodstein.ca. That's WOOD-STEIN.ca. You can support this podcast by becoming a patron at patreon.com/Colin Burrows. Like, share, comment, follow, and support the Woodstein Media Podcast on whatever platform you listen to your podcasts. Have a wonderful day. Go support some independent musicians.